Its roof stretches from the steamy northern tropics, thousands of kilometers south, to the continent's bleak and windswept tip. And it's here, a stone's throw from Antarctica, where our journey begins. Patagonia's chilling landscapes dominate the southern extremes of this vast continent. Snow-capped peaks rise thousands of meters, while large mammals graze in the valleys. These guanacos are wild relatives of the domesticated llama and alpaca. Ruling the skies above, the majestic Andean condor, the world's largest bird of prey. He's also unique to South America. In full flight, its wingspan reaches over 3 meters. With surprising grace and the keenest eyesight in the animal kingdom, they scan the ground for carrion. Throughout the day, these mighty birds ride powerful updrafts of air. Patagonia offers two important features the condor needs to survive. The mountains overlook vast open spaces, the condor's source of food, and high cliffs from which to launch their enormous bulk. At the southern tip of South America, landscapes vary little. Consequently, the variety of animal life is small. In nearby lowlands, dwarfed by mighty peaks, more and more unique birds join the parade. Upland geese belong to a family that is widespread throughout the world. This species, however, is unique to the shores and grasslands of northern Patagonia. These are large, aggressive birds. And in the sparse and simple ecosystems of the far south, few predators bother them. Even a passing fox does little to ruffle their feathers. If anything, the fox seems more wary of the geese. Their world is a grand, simple one of cool winds, open skies, water, and grass. Moving through central Argentina and Uruguay, grasslands stretch as far as the eye can see. These seemingly endless fields are known as the Pampas, home to Pampas deer and the impressive giant anteater. The most distinctive bird found wandering across these rolling plains is the flightless rhea. It's South America's version of the African ostrich, or the Australian emu. All three are close relatives. For most of the year, male rheas live alone. At the start of spring, their behavior changes. And as the urge to breed takes hold, the males start making some stylish moves. Their strategy is to attract as many females as possible, the most successful individuals ending up with a dozen or more potential mates. Early in the breeding season, they constantly strive to impress their harem with elaborately drooping wings. Occasionally they break off to tackle rival males. Once the eggs are laid, male rheas take sole charge of their future offspring. In contrast, looking after the youngsters is a team effort for the burrowing owl, another resident of this near treeless landscape. But like the rhea, it has few options when time comes to build a nest. Consequently, the species has developed two unusual characteristics. Unlike most owls, it's active during the day, and it nests underground. Usually, burrowing owls commandeer the disused home of some other animal, like a rodent or prairie dog. By day, they stand guard at the entrance to their underground chamber, scanning the landscape for danger. Where grass meets water, a new world emerges. Dotted throughout the Pampas and other South American habitats, there are king-sized swamps that encourage birds to gather in enormous flocks. They line the skies, cruising from the nightly roosts to daily feeding grounds. The shallow waters are choked with plants. Large rodents, nutrias, forage in the boggy grass. Caiman and aquatic snakes haunt the shallows. There's also a most unusual local, renowned for its ability to walk on water plants. The jacana has enormously elongated toes, allowing it to spread its weight over a large area. It walks with grace on floating plants that would otherwise sink beneath the weight of ordinary birds. The jacana feeds on insects and other tiny creatures living among the water lilies. And its distinctive feet allow for a unique lifestyle, untroubled by competitors. Another master of the swamp is the limpkin. With similarly long legs, but much smaller toes. It feeds only on freshwater snails, using its long, down-curved bill to winkle them from their shells. Though often active by day, limpkins are widely referred to as crying birds, a name inspired by spooky wails uttered mainly at night. An even more bizarre marsh resident is the southern screamer, named in honor of their harsh, penetrating calls. Large and ungainly, screamers belong to a small family of marsh birds that live only in South America. They're distantly related to ducks and other wildfowl. Even the airspace immediately above the swamps is controlled by birds with unique characteristics, like the long-winged harrier. This bird of prey has a long tail and broad wings, both features combining to give it remarkable control even when flying at low speeds. Sailing and tilting on the wind, the harrier can spend hours aloft, scanning the ground for prey. Travelling further north, the pampas grasslands eventually give way to scattered trees. Spread mainly through northern Argentina, Paraguay, and southern Brazil, woodlands are the next major stamping ground for South American birds. A new day dawns in the woodlands. It's warmer here, and rainfall is slightly more regular. The ever-increasing variety of plants in turn supports an even greater diversity of birds. As more and more animals join the fray, it becomes important for each species to set itself apart from the rest. The dawn chorus is one of numerous ways in which birds display their individuality. Triggered by the rising sun, each day the woodlands host an inspirational opera. Many of these sounds are combined with strange displays. The oropendula's gurgling trills, for example, are performed in unison with a deep bowing action. The bird seems about to fall off its perch. But song and dance isn't the only way to flaunt unique qualities. Like a pneumatic drill, a lineated woodpecker rapidly hammers against a tree trunk. It's his way of warning off rival males. He reinforces his claim with strident yelping calls. Apart from their ability to bash beaks in a way which would give most other animals a severe headache, lineated woodpeckers are also among the largest of their family. And there's another distinct advantage for having such a tough head. Woodpeckers can excavate their own homes, Drilling holes in trunks, woodpecker style, is one of many nesting options in landscapes where trees dominate. This honeiro is out collecting for a different kind of nursery. Firm branches are used as foundations for nests made from mud. Bit by bit, the mud, mixed with grass and roots, is plastered into place and left to dry. The nest takes several weeks to build, and both parents-to-be share in its construction. Honeiro nests are a fairly common sight. They last for months, long after the young have flown. This elaborate creation is a very effective defense against attackers. Inside, the nests are highly complex, but unfortunately there's no way of examining the inner chamber without causing damage. Also striving to build an impressive nest, this monk parakeet is out gathering sticks. It's unusual behavior for a parrot, since most members of the family nest exclusively in tree hollows. The sticks are being transported to a nearby construction site, a large community nest shared by perhaps six pairs. Their tangle of twigs is like a bird apartment block. Each resident pair has both its own entrance and inner breeding chamber. Like other parrots, the parents work together to find food for their hungry chicks. Popular at mealtime is a mashed selection of seeds served up by either mum or dad. Nearby, another pair of monk parakeets is behaving in an unusual fashion. They've discovered a tree hollow and chosen to call it home. Such hollows are used by many different kinds of birds, and as there are never enough to go around, they're constantly in high demand. The parakeets are in bitter dispute with a pair of flycatchers and are willing to defend their hollow at all costs. While parrots are normally vegetarian, woodpeckers typically eat insects. They clutch tree trunks with powerful clawed feet and brace themselves by leaning backwards on a specially stiffened tail. This gives excellent leverage as they hammer away at the bark, digging for wood-boring grubs. Another insect eater, the wood creeper, also searches for insects beneath bark. No battering routine here. He simply uses his slender bill as a probe. If a bird's not after insects or seeds, it may be looking for nectar. Hummingbirds are renowned for their unique style of flight, the only birds that can truly hover. They've developed this remarkable ability just to get at flowers too delicate to support the weight of nectar-feeding birds. Perched in mid-air, they pump nectar, using the rich stream of liquid to fuel their screaming metabolism. Beating at more than 70 times a second, their blurred wings move so fast they produce a distinctive humming sound. Of the hundreds of different hummingbirds in South America, most are tiny. Indeed, several compete for the title of smallest of all birds. Some are only slightly larger than a bumblebee. But of all the many geographical faces of South America, our final territory is by far the most impressive. The renowned rainforests of the Amazon, dominating the northern half of the continent. This is where the greatest variety of animals and plants are found. Gathering storm clouds announce the coming of the rains, dumping volumes of water and feeding thousands of waterways, large and small. Rivers like this serve as highways for birds and other forest creatures. Threading their way through dense tropical jungles, they offer the easiest route upstream for all kinds of wildlife. Birds, beasts, and butterflies crowd the riverbanks. Capybara, the world's largest rodent, are on one side, hungry caiman on the other. A family of rare Orinoco geese tackles the fast-flowing waters. The skimmer, distantly related to gulls and terns, is one of the most agile of river birds. They gather in large flocks and loaf on river sandbanks. When disturbed, the mob takes flight. The most distinctive feature of skimmers is their uneven bills, with the lower part much longer than the upper part. This remarkable adaptation allows them to fish in a unique way. They fly low and fast over streams, their lower bill slicing the surface, ready to snap shut on any fish unable to dart clear. Watching the skimmers on their regular sorties are tiny sand-coloured nighthawks. By day, they gather in large flocks. Dozing on sun-drenched river sandbanks, they're conserving energy in readiness for nighttime raids on moths, their preferred food. Unlike people, birds don't sweat. And out on the roasting sand, This nighthawk keeps cool by fluttering its throat. It's an action similar to that of a dog panting. Further upriver, cattle egrets live in communal roosts, relying on the principle of safety and numbers. As the day dawns, they break away, cruising downstream for their shallow water feeding grounds. In these early morning hours, the rainforest bursts to life. It's as though every animal must be up and active before the sun gets too hot or the rains erupt. This oxbow lake, marooned when the main river changed course, teems with even more life. In some areas, rare otters play in the shallows. At one end of the lake, yellow-rumped caciques have established a colony on an isolated stump. This can easily be defended from all directions. These caciques are relatives of American blackbirds. In the early hours, the males seek to impress, singing and bowing, showing off their yellow rumps and wingtips. The aim is to sound good and look great. On their community stumps, each pair builds one dangling nest. Females are devoted to incubating eggs and raising chicks. Males work as one to defend their families. As a sneaky troupial arrives on the scene, their displays become more aggressive. Near relatives of caciques, troupials live in a similar way. Both eat a wide range of food and often raid the nests of other birds to prey on eggs and chicks. Sometimes they attack each other. These troupials appear to be testing the cacique sentries. No doubt they're gauging the chances of snatching an ill-guarded chick or two for breakfast. But this time, at least, it seems the defenders are in full control. The troupials are repelled, empty-handed. Unique to these waterside forests, howitzans have no close relatives. Far from acrobatic, these ungainly-looking birds are clumsy flyers. The main reason why they're so cumbersome on the wing ultimately relates to food. Howitzans are the only birds that eat only leaves, a diet which is high in bulk, but lacking in nutrition. As a result, they perch quietly for most of the day. Howitzans have survived against the odds because they're relatively large, live in a stable environment, and rarely need to fly. Moving deeper into the rainforest, away from major rivers, another world emerges. Here, complexity and diversity dominate. So why do so many different animals live in this dank, dripping environment? The main reason is that rainforests are roughly divided into three levels, each dramatically different. Here, at ground level, there's filtered light, and the temperature hardly varies. Water, warmth, and shelter are everywhere. A constant rain of leaves, seeds, and fruits delivers food for ground-dwelling creatures. South America as a whole certainly supports more birds than any other continent, but it's in the rainforest where most of them live. 4 out of 5 South American birds have carved a living amongst the lush Amazon jungles. Guans feed down here, but these distant cousins of chickens are not exclusively ground dwellers. They often swap the forest floor for low trees, slinking along the branches with surprising ease for such large birds. The greatest diversity of bird life occurs in the rainforest's middle level. There's more food here than on the forest floor, and it's more protected than in the canopy. Also, there are secluded places where nests can be hidden from predators. It's the dense foliage that offers protection, even for colorful birds. Another unique local that divides its time between lower branches and forest floor is the motmot. They nest in holes in the ground, but perch in trees. They're distinctive birds, with serrations along the cutting edges of their bills. They also wag their tails from side to side, not up and down like other birds. Tails pale tips adorned with strange racket-shaped blobs are the strangest feature. These form when specially weakened feathers break away to create this gap. Puffbirds are unique to the Amazon. Dumpy, fat-headed little birds, they spend most of the day sitting quietly in the lower branches. If a predator appears, they sit dead still. Even when moving, their drab color helps keep them camouflaged. Trogons are more widespread throughout the world's rainforests. The females, like this one, are relatively drab. They feed on fruit and crawling insects, especially caterpillars. Trogons sit quietly on branches, subjecting their surroundings to thorough scrutiny. If a potential meal comes into view, they take action. Sharing the same neighborhood, a jacama is also about to hunt. Instead of targeting insects crawling on leaves, this vivacious and colorful little bird picks its victims from midair. Setting off on agile sallies, it targets dragonflies, butterflies, and moths. Mission successful, it returns to a branch. Its scissor-like bill dismembers the catch. And finally, the jacama swallows. A tour through the rainforest's middle level wouldn't be complete without sighting a male mannequin, the most flamboyant resident of all. Certainly they look brilliant, but it's the incredible courtship displays that steal the show. An inspiration for Michael Jackson's moonwalk? Probably not. This red-capped mannequin is simply trying to lure a mate. The world of the upper canopy offers the greatest contrasts. Here, treetops are exposed to wind, rain, and glaring sun. The birds are very different too. With their enormous beaks, toucans are among the most exotic of South American birds. They may look top-heavy, but the bill is in fact filled with spongy tissue that weighs little. Most mysterious is how or why such a bizarre adornment evolved in the first place. This bird uses its great length to full advantage, reaching for fruit at the tips of slender twigs. The beak also acts as a kind of billboard. Each species and gender supports bills with different colors and patterns, making it easy to pick the right partner when it comes time to mate. And when mating occurs, toucans nest in tree hollows. However, you can't always assume that when a toucan enters a hollow, it is simply checking on its chicks. Often they have much more sinister intentions. On occasions, toucans vary their fruit diet. Part meat eaters, they raid the nests of others, targeting eggs and baby birds. A chestnut-billed toucan has uncovered the grass-built nest of a lesser kiskadee. Too small to ward off such a large aggressor, the parents protest and scold. The toucan tears the nest apart to get at the helpless chicks. Once this chick is devoured, the toucan will resume its more regular diet of fruit, for a while at least. Macaws, too, are fruit eaters. But being the most spectacular of rainforest birds and the largest of all parrots doesn't guarantee a reliable food supply. Fruit has its drawbacks. Firstly, it may lack essential nutrients, which helps to explain why so many birds change their diet from time to time. The other difficulty, especially for macaws, is that it's often hard to find enough ripe fruit to go around. In certain seasons, there's likely to be a glut. At other times, parrots are forced to either search far and wide for anything fresh or accept what's nearby, whether it's ripe or not. By eating unripe fruit, parrots suffer just as we would after eating a sour green apple. They get stomach ache. Parrots have their own unique answer to this problem. They eat clay. Deep in the forest, dusky-billed parrotlets visit a source of clay hidden beneath a hole in the ground. Effectively, they're getting their daily dose of medicine. There's an element of danger in this activity, for the parrotlets must fly very low, exposing themselves to enemies on the ground. They're constantly wary, moving carefully down through the branches before darting underground. No one has yet figured out exactly what the clay does, but whatever it is, it must be good. Why else would you want to eat mouthfuls of mud? Such small secret sources don't answer the needs of all parrots. Many others take part in a much more spectacular solution. Throughout the Amazon, steep banks of clay, carved away by rivers, are targeted by hundreds or even thousands of parrots. They come daily from miles around, gathering in excited, screeching and squabbling mobs. At this site each morning, first to arrive are purple-headed parrots, mealy Amazons, conures, and other smaller birds. Initially, they gather in the treetops. Then they move down, eventually grappling with a slippery cliff face. It's a feeding frenzy that focuses on little more than clay. The smaller birds scatter when the green-winged macaws arrive. These enormous parrots climb slowly down before finally reaching the clay. Grappling with the cliff face, they break off large clumps, though exactly how much clay each bird eats remains unknown. Thank you. Every day, forest life is directed by intriguing rituals such as this. Many may not be quite so spectacular, but together they combine to make South America the bird capital of the world.